In this episode, I'm joined by Alexander Lee, who is a specialist in the cultural and political history of the Renaissance in Italy. He is the author of multiple books, including Humanism and Empire, The Ugly Renaissance, and Petrarch and Saint Augustine, Classical Scholarship, Christian Theology, and the Origins of the Renaissance in Italy. In this episode, we discuss his latest book, Machiavelli, His Life and Times, alongside discussions about Renaissance Italy, Machiavellian politics, and the philosophy of Lucretius. I'd like to say a big thank you to all my patrons and paid subscribers for making all of this work possible, and if you'd like to support Hermitix or become part of the community, please find the links in the description below. Enjoy. Okay, so Alexander Lee, thanks very much for joining us on Hermitix podcast.
Thanks for inviting me. It's great to be with you.
So we're going to be discussing your recently published biography of Niccolo Machiavelli, which is called Machiavelli, His Life and Times. So before we jump in on that, just give us an overview of your, you know, about what it is you do and your work and why it was you decided to write this biography.
Well, I'm, as you probably expect, a Renaissance historian. I specialise in the cultural and political history of Italy between the 14th and the 16th centuries. I've written on a reasonably wide range of topics within that field, starting really at the beginning in the 14th century with people like Petrarch. And I've written quite a lot about political thought. So really, it was fairly inevitable that I would come to Machiavelli in some way or another. A few years ago, I started reading a bit more systematically about Machiavelli's life and works, and I was struck by the fact that although there have been a wonderful range of books published about Machiavelli, they fall into one of two categories. Either you have the fairly kind of intellectual biographies, the studies of the thought of Machiavelli, or you get the kind of works that are more human, that look at the man. The second lot tends to be quite convinced that he's a very brilliant man from birth, etc. So it occurred to me that actually what we needed was some way of bringing the two of these things together and having a more three-dimensional portrait of Machiavelli out there. Also, one that was capable of looking at him not only as a highly original thinker, but also as a man very much like you and me, well, certainly like me anyway, that's to say somebody who makes mistakes in his life, who doesn't always get things right, who quite often is on the wrong side of history's great dramas. So my purpose in writing this biography really was to produce maybe to call it a total biography is the wrong way of describing it, but a more human biography of Machiavelli that showed him warts and all.
Before we jump in on the Hermitix question, I just jotted something down because it's really interesting to me. I was recently had an interview on Giordano Bruno, and at least in philosophy, which is my background, the philosophy of the Renaissance is almost entirely overlooked. Any sort of course in philosophy will generally jump over that entire few hundred years and, you know, ignore it. And I mean, in terms of history, as a historian of the Renaissance, I'm, you know, obviously you're going to be a little bit biased, but do you feel it's overlooked generally?
Well, I am going to be very biased, yes. But you are right in saying that if you look at most undergraduate courses in, or even master's courses in the history of philosophy, the Renaissance is this kind of gap. You might get figures like Machiavelli being covered from the point of view of political philosophy, but insofar as the more technical works, the more technical aspects of philosophy are concerned, epistemology, metaphysics, etc., it's sort of a gap. That is sad, because as you've gathered from your podcast about Bruno, it's tremendously exciting, but in a way it's perhaps not unexpected, because a lot of philosophy in the Renaissance takes place within the framework of competing classical traditions, Platonism versus Aristotelianism, etc., etc. And so to get into it is sometimes a little bit less, you have to follow a less direct route to get into it than you would when you're looking at, for example, classical philosophy or more recent philosophy. That's unfortunate. But it is tremendously exciting. I mean, I'm just about to publish a short encyclopedia entry on the idea of the immortality of the soul in the Renaissance. And this is a huge issue at the time. It ultimately leads nowhere. It's a bit of an intellectual cul-de-sac because no conclusion is ever reached. But ultimately, it provides a set of tools with which philosophers can engage with a much broader range of questions in psychology and even metaphysics. And it finds echoes in, for example, Descartes, relatively later. So really, I think one of the best ways of looking at Renaissance philosophy is as equipping the discipline with tools that it can use to do other things later. Now, there are some great introductions aside from your own, wonderful podcast, which is dealing with a number of major figures. Peter Adamson, for example, is covering Renaissance philosophy fairly well in his series, A History of Philosophy Without Any Gaps. There's some great books companions that have been published, I think it was James Hankins who produced a Cambridge Companion to Renaissance Philosophy as well. And those give a really, really good overview. So if you're interested in filling in the gap, as it were, those are a great place to begin.
Sorry, I'm now really, really intrigued as to your Hermetics question answer, which is three thinkers or figures, living or dead, into a room. And listen in on the conversation. Who do you pick? We can obviously include Machiavelli here as we're talking about him.
Well, this is a really interesting question. Had you asked me any three people I would put in a room with Machiavelli, I'd give a very different answer.
Okay, we can do that as well. We can do that one after.
I'll tell you why I'd give different answers in a minute. If I were to pick three thinkers, I would pick, I'm afraid, predictably three Renaissance figures. I'd pick Dante Alighieri, Francesco Petrarca, another poet, and Machiavelli's friend, Francesco Guicciardini. Why would I pick these three? Well, they're all Florentines. They all come from the same city. They're all people who have a big impact on Machiavelli's life. When he goes into, not exile, but when he's sacked from his job in 1512 and he's then arrested. After he's released, he retreats to his family farm where he lives, as he says, like through Galeoffo, a lousy good for nothing. One of the things he does is he reads his favourite writers, and his favourite writers are Dante and Petrarch. Why are they so important to him? Well, okay, they're really important poets, but also they share his experiences. Each of them had been forced to live in disgrace. Dante was exiled from Florence in the early 14th century. Petrarch's father was exiled at the same time. And they both spent the most productive years of their life outside the city, very much out of favour. So I would love to hear what they had to say to Machiavelli and what he had to say to them about being out in the political wilderness. Guicciardini is kind of the opposite. He is really successful where Machiavelli is not, but a lot of his thought about history, about constitutions, about politics, operates in dialogue with Machiavelli's. So, you know, I'd like to hear what they had to say from each other. We have their letters, lots of letters between them, and those are full of fun, full of intellectual sparks, but I'd like to listen in.
Okay. Where do you think that conversation would head to first?
Oh, fortune. I have no doubt whatsoever that the one topic they would start by talking about is the vicissitudes of fortune, its kindness and its cruelty. Petrarch, one of his best known works in his lifetime and shortly after his lifetime, was a book called the De Remedies Utrusque Fortune, Remedies for the Two Types of Fortune. And in that, it's to modern readers, it's quite a boring read, but it's a series of long dialogues between various allegorical figures who are confronted either with really good luck, the blessings of good fortune, or really rubbish luck. And it's a guide to how to cope with that. Dante, of course, is fortune does play a role, but it's slightly less present in his writings. But for Machiavelli, this is the big issue. What fortune, how fortune impacts on our daily lives and on states, and how we should respond to that is the question that runs through all of his works. And of course, it's central to his own life because he was always getting it wrong.
So what does Machiavelli have a different definition of fortune than we commonly ascribe to it?
Well, Machiavelli doesn't ever really offer a neat definition of what he means by fortune. The closest he comes to giving a description of it is when he describes in The Prince and in a couple of other places fortune as a woman. And unfortunately, the way he elaborates on this is pretty misogynistic, so I'm going to give you a brief warning before I say anything further. Machiavelli was always being told off by his wife for being a bit of a naughty boy. So perhaps inevitably, when he came to picture fortune as a woman, he imagined her as someone who was always going to be, you know, a bit wild, telling him off, sometimes delivering great delight, sometimes, you know, giving him an earful and being very, very unpredictable. It's a highly misogynistic image. But this had the point of this was that he wanted to suggest that if you wanted to master woman, master fortune, you had to treat fortune as you would a woman. And this is where he gets really misogynistic. So I'm sorry for what follows again. He says you have to be very firm, and sometimes you have to be even quite rough. Now, that view of fortune, how to cope with it, is very distinctive of Machiavelli and contrasts very clearly with how Petrarch viewed fortune in some respects. Obviously, his interest is slightly different. His focus is slightly different. But Petrarch is much more stoical in some respects. He's interested in philosophical responses to the vicissitudes of fate. He is more concerned with using reason to master your emotions, etc., etc. So Machiavelli is really interested in taking control of your own fortune and fate, really. And he advises real decisive action, even when it might be a bit tough by modern standards. As I said, the image he uses is quite unpleasant, but there you go.
There you go. It's of the times, as they would say. So who were the three that you would put in with Machiavelli, and why would you put them in there?
Oh, the non-thinkers. Ah, well, I would pick his own friends, his closest friends. Yeah. I'd pick a guy called Biagio Bonaccorsi, who worked with him in Florence's chancellery. I would put his friend Donato del Corno, who ran a shop which doubled probably as a bordel. And I would probably pick his other friend Francesco Vettori, who is a correspondent, he's a diplomat. He also is quite a fun lover as well. And I put these three in a room because they were always trading letters. They were always getting up to no good together. And, you know, we can see from what they say to each other that they had a lot of fun. So if I wanted an interesting night, I would have Machiavelli, Petrarch, Dante and Guicciardini. If I wanted a fun night, I'd have Machiavelli, Biagio, Donato and Vettori.
Okay, that makes sense. That makes sense. Which one would you, if you had to choose, which one would you opt for? The fun night?
Oh, the second one, obviously.
Yeah, of course. So getting into his biography, one of the interesting things you said about at the start about why you wrote this book was that some of the books which focus on his life come at it from a position of assuming that he was, should we say, innately an amazing or great person. And one of the things that surprised me in reading this book is that it's very, very apparent from the off that he isn't. He's an extremely hard worker, but he has an extremely turbulent childhood and upbringing, to say the least, in a certain way. I wondered if you could expand on, you know, on his childhood and earlier years and how they sort of affected him, or if you think they affected him.
Well, they certainly did affect him. Machiavelli's family liked to claim that they were fairly noble stock. They trace their origins to a little village outside Florence, but and they owned there was a family palazzo in the centre of Florence, not far from the Ponte Vecchio today. It's been destroyed. It was destroyed in the Second World War, but we know where it was, and we have a fairly good idea of what it was like. However, in the 150 years or so before Machiavelli's birth, their fortunes had declined fairly dramatically. Although they were all fairly well educated, the various branches of the family were a shadow of what they once claimed to be. In the family palazzo, it was divided up into several houses, separate houses, so it was quite a bustling place. Each house was inhabited by a different branch of the family. And of these branches, perhaps the most unsuccessful was the branch headed by Machiavelli's dad, Bernardo. He was a nice guy. We have his diary, Libro di Ricordi, which he kept, not a diary in the modern sense, but like a kind of occasional book, really, in which he recorded his expenses, his purchases, important things that go on, major decisions. So we get an image of a quite a well-educated man, a learned man, and a family man, a kind, gentleman. There's no doubt that he and his wife provided a warm home for Machiavelli and his siblings. And he was surrounded, the young Machiavelli was surrounded by love from an early age. But Bernardo suffers from a number of disadvantages. He seems to have qualified as a lawyer, but he never practices. There are several reasons for this, but we're not completely certain which is the most decisive. One is that he was a public debtor. Though he owned a couple of farms outside the city, he was always falling behind with his expenses. He was always spending more than he had, and if you owed money to the city, this was a major impediment to political and professional life. The second reason is that he may have been illegitimate. It's not certain. In fairness, the probability is that he was, he was illegitimate. Legitimate child, but because there was a question mark over it, over his birth, that entailed certain social issues and may have affected his membership of certain other bodies. And thirdly, one of his kinsmen, not a close kinsman, but one of his kinsmen, was involved in a rather botched plot against the Medici family in the past. And although Bernardo was never involved, a cloud very much hung over the family, and that affected his prospects too, more politically perhaps than professionally. Anyway, so what we have is Bernardo, who is a lawyer, never really practiced his profession and is always a bit hard up. He is, however, still very much involved in the intellectual life of the city. He's a good friend of the Chancellor, Bartolomeo Scala. He also is invited to prepare a topographical index to Livy's History of Rome. Now, that might seem like a very dull task, and in fairness, it probably was, but it testifies to his learning. This is a task that requires some skill, not just as a linguist, but also as an historian, and a philologist. So he's obviously well thought of. So how did this impact Machiavelli? Well, this sense of poverty has a, not poverty, but certainly hardship, has a lasting effect on Machiavelli. It means that he doesn't have a lot of money, of inherited money, to fall back on, which a number of other major players in Florentine politics and administration do. That means he has to have a job. And as I'm sure we're going to discuss later on, that means that sometimes when he's on the wrong side of development, he has to change his allegiances pretty fast. This isn't always successful, but it means that he has to be flexible and fluid, and he tries. The other impact is that it exposes him to certain influences, intellectual influences, which will last throughout his career. Livy is the most important here. We can't construct this completely, but it is almost certainly due to his father that he cultivates such a fondness for Livy from an early age, and that will affect his later and most important writings.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, of course, the discourses of Livy is probably his sort of second most well-known work, obviously after The Prince. And it's interesting that you mentioned early on there the Medicis and the influence they had over Florence at the time, because you mention that even though they don't rule in a governmental or sovereign sense, not in any official sense, their power, due to their financial situation, so we say, and their sort of, I guess, history and lineage, is so great that they, for all purposes, they do rule. And it, you know, if you agree with that, this sort of mode of covert private governance via just wealth, do you think that had an influence on Machiavelli? And the fact that under this sort of pseudo reign of the Medicis, Florence was incredible. It was an absolutely astounding place to be at the time. Do you think that the combination of the two sort of had an effect on Machiavelli's politics?
Yes and no. Let me first take a step back. You're right in saying that in the period up to 1494, the Medici do exercise a certain control over Florentine government in an unofficial capacity. They very, very rarely occupy any official role. They very rarely hold office. They do it on occasions, but it's infrequent. They exercise control through a network of clients, through the exercise of patronage, people with whom they have family ties, business ties, people who owe them favors, etc., etc., are those who they ensure are appointed to certain committees or who are made eligible for selection to certain bodies. Florence, this time being governed a republic officially, which was governed through a large connection, a collection of different committees and magistracies. So that's how they exercise authority. And you're right in saying that the period of the Medici's dominance of Florentine politics before 1494 is one of the great cultural periods in Florence's history. How does this affect Machiavelli? Well, it affects him in, I think, two ways. First of all, it illustrates to him that political authority in this period in Florence is very much a matter of your relations with a large number of people. It's not so much a matter of public opinion per se, as it is of establishing networks. It shows that if you do want to your regime to have any kind of permanence, then you need not only to appease the greater bulk of people who inhabit Florence, the popolo, but you also need to have some way of managing those who are slightly wealthier and forming a network of dependence from the better off. And that's an idea which is going to stay with him throughout his life and is going to be an issue which is fairly important in The Prince and in the Discorsi. I should add that these two groups that I've mentioned, the better off people, who we could call the grandi, if you like, the great people, who tend to fill the majority of offices in Florence and who form the bulk of the Medici's allies, are often at variance with the greater number of the people, the popolo in Florence. They have quite different objectives. Machiavelli later says in The Prince and the Discorsi that their ends are completely and irreconcilably opposed, whereas the grandi want only to dominate, the popolo want only not to be dominated, and there is no middle ground between these positions. So if you're going to stay in control, you need to have a network of support at a practical level, but more appropriately, you need, more broadly speaking, you need a way of managing these two. The Medici had done it quite well by ruling through committees, but also holding the people in check. But they'd also done it very badly as well. And this is an important lesson for Machiavelli. They had often faced a lot of trouble. So when Machiavelli's quite young and still at school, something called the Pazzi conspiracy breaks out, whereby some of those people whom the Medici hadn't succeeded in integrating into their network of dependents, people who aspired to have a bigger share in Florentine government, and people who aspired to supplant the Medici's position as financial masters of northern and central Italy, try to oust them. And it's headed by a family called the Pazzi family. They try to, they and their affiliates try to kill the head of the Medici family and his brother in the cathedral. They get it half right. They kill Lorenzo's brother, but they fail to kill Lorenzo, and it all falls apart cataclysmically. So they don't really manage to do it very well. And that's a major problem from Machiavelli's point of view. He sees their rule as being one of qualified but fatally flawed success. That's to say, they do harness this network, but it's really the dominance of a single faction. It's not harmonizing a city, it's providing a dominant faction's control. The other major lesson, I'll do this very briefly because I've gone on for too long already. The other major lesson that Machiavelli learns is that because, as you rightly said, there is an association between the dominance of a particular regime and a bit of cultural efflorescence, he recognizes that if you're going to get on in Florence, particularly when he's a young man, you need, or you can, use your learning and your culture as a route to favor. He tries this when he's in his 20s. He writes a series of poems to some of the younger members of the Medici family that course with homoerotic affection and quite sweet in a way. They don't work. He chooses exactly the wrong moment to do this. He writes these poems just a few months before the Medici are kicked out of Florence. But later on, he effectively tries the same approach. The prince is a very focused work of political advice, but it's conceived in the same way. It's an attempt to try and recommend himself to the Medici again when they return from exile in 1512 by using his culture and learning. And he does it again with other works like the Florentine Histories, etc.
So you don't think he had any sympathies towards that false mode of governance, which is largely behind the scenes, the Medici's way of domination? You don't think he had any, he only learnt from that but wasn't sympathetic to the actual outcomes?
I think this actually goes to there's two parts to this. Number one, did Machiavelli perceive the Medici as working behind the scenes in some kind of shadowy way that isn't any way admirable? And number two, did Machiavelli have any particular affection for a specific system of governance?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
The first one, I don't think is really answerable, to be honest, at all. The second one is a massively important debate in Machiavelli studies.
Okay.
I would answer it by saying that I think it is very easy to... Okay, in Machiavelli's works, he distinguishes clearly between principalities and republics.
Mm-hmm.
And this is a division which is extremely... it's a vision that we find it inherently attractive. But I should say two things to qualify it. Number one, although they are very different, they actually share a lot in common as well. Any form of principality in Renaissance Italy, and particularly a unofficial principality like that of the Medici,
mm-hmm.
Still had to work with organs that were very similar to those that you found in a republic.
Mm-hmm.
Indeed, so much so that when the Medici are dominating Florentine politics between 1434 and 1494, it is still officially a republic. Mm-hmm. They are exercising a kind of, a kind of princely power. It's a bit of a crude way of putting it. They're never, ever addressed in that way. But they are really officially just important people, unofficially important people in a republic. They have to work through committees. Their power resides in influence. So too, if you look at the period after their return, they have a more solid grip on the city, partly because soon after their return, one of their number is elected Pope, and then another one gets elected a short time after, which gives them a certain purchase. But they are preoccupied with this question of how they are going to work with the organs of the Republic in order to assure their control, and how to rejig the constitution so it works more in their favour, but without changing its Republican credential. The same can also be seen have in other actual princely states where somebody is, you know, has a title, is a lord of a city. They still have to work with institutions. There's been some very good work, recent work done on Lucca, the Guinigi in Lucca, for example. And it's been shown that further to work of Jones, for example, that actually when you get down to the nuts and bolts of how government is conducted, it's apart from the existence of this lordly figure at the top, there's actually very little to choose between them. Now, the second point that I'd like to make in this regard is that Machiavelli writes a book of advice for princes who want to stay in control, the prince. Mm-hmm. He also writes a book, the Discorsi, which looks at states more generally and appears to be particularly interested in how republics preserve their liberty, etc. And of course, during his time as second chancellor of the Florentine Republic between 1498 and 1512, he is preoccupied with the question of how a republic should function. Does this mean that he has a change of heart? Is he at one moment a committed republican and then becomes suddenly this Medician convert who wants to see princely rule? I think that really is a mistaken way of looking at things, because he is really at each phase in his life trying to put it crudely, keep his job, get mm-hmm. and keep yeah. his job. We talked earlier about how he doesn't have a lot of family money to fall back on, so he needs to pay his bills, and he can only pay his bills if he's got some form of employment or some can benefit from some kind of patronage from those who exercise a form of power. So he writes many of his works accordingly. The prince is designed to get a job by showing how useful he can be. The Discorsi is slightly different. That's written for the benefit predominantly of a group of friends who he meets in the Orti Ocellari, the Rucellai Gardens. And so also later on he writes works which are more focused on rejigging constitutions, which are also designed to serve this purpose. So really his major concern is being an advisor to who have been useful to whoever he perceives as being in a position of influence.
Mm-hmm. So I'm not going to ask you the difficult question directly. So this question of Machiavelli's, you mentioned that in Machiavelli's studies, this is heavily debated what his personal preferred mode of governance would be. Instead of just asking you that question, why is that question a difficult one to answer? You know, why is there so much debate within it?
Why is there so much? Well, as I suggested, you have several works of Machiavelli's which appear to be concerned with quite different things. Mm-hmm. That we've got The Prince, written for the most part in 1513, but revised at various points later on, which asks the question, you know, can a prince keep control of his state? How can he preserve his authority in turbulent times? It doesn't consider anything else. That's its only focus. Mm-hmm. A few years later, he produces the Discorsi, the discourses on the first decade of Livy, and it's ostensibly a commentary on Livy's study of Roman history, but actually it asks the question, how do states guarantee their greatness? How do they preserve their liberty and grow as a result. He is consciously broad in his focus, but it's fairly obvious that he is, because he's talking about Rome, he's really talking about how a republic can survive. Now, the debate really focuses on the relationship between these two texts. Mm-hmm. And the specifically how the, or whether the discourse he differs significantly from the prince. Mm. Is it really a republican work? Or is it concerned mainly with states in general? Are there any similarities between the advice he gives in the Discorsi and the advice he offers in the Prince? It is difficult because they are two very, very different works in conception. They're addressed to very, very different audiences for very, very different purposes. The first one being addressed to, it's dedicated ultimately to Lorenzo, the younger Lorenzo de' Medici, who is sort of heading up the Medici's affairs in Florence after their return from exile. The second book, the Discorsi, is dedicated to his friends in the Rucellai Gardens. This is a group of chums who meet. Some of them are related to the Medici, some of them are political outsiders, some of them go on to launch coups against the Medici and ultimately take power after the Medici are kicked out again later on. But Machiavelli isn't really inciting them to rebel or anything like that. So they are very different books in conception. And it's difficult to know how far we should take account of that difference in genre. From my point of view, I think it's important to remember that they are not written as constituent parts of a coherent body of political theory. Mm-hmm. They're not intended to be part one and part two of Machiavelli's big book of how to do politics. Mm. They are occasional works written in response to Machiavelli's personal circumstances. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And as such, I don't think it's really useful to ask the question, is he a committed Republican? Is he a committed proponent or exponent of princely rule? The ideas that there is some continuity of ideas between the two works, I'm sure we'll talk about that later on. The core ideas are essentially the same. There are some differences, but really he's responding to different needs at different times, and he does need a job sometimes.
Is there any personal documentation of Machiavelli's which isn't written in any point of sort of personal constraint where it might lead us to understand what his personal beliefs actually were? Because obviously if you're writing something such as The Prince or The Discourses, as you've stated, they're written in times where he needs a job, so you're going to eschew it, sort of like when you write your thesis, you eschew it to the bias of your tutor to get a better grade. Is there any personal letters or personal documentation which sort of, you know, where he says, oh, actually I quite like X or Y?
No, is the simple answer. not that I can think of. But I think it raises an interesting point. Your question raises a very interesting point. Today we're very familiar with the idea that people are or can be defined by certain very clear ideological positions. They are Democrats or authoritarians, they're liberals or socialists, they're conservatives or whatever. I don't really think that it's always helpful to think in those terms when we're talking of the pre-modern period, and particularly the early 16th century. The practice of politics in when Machiavelli is writing, although it is beginning to assume a more kind of concrete, practical focus, that is to say, how we organise states, it is constructed along very different lines. You very rarely find people wanting to saying, oh, we want to restore a republic now, or we want to institute a princely regime, particularly in France, that doesn't really happen at all. They think more in terms of kind of regime changes, shifting the personnel at the top, shifting its focus. But even when we see big shifts in Florentine history, such as when you see the shift from the Medici's first in power to the theocratic republic of Girolamo Savonarola, 1494 to 1498, to the republic of headed by Soderini, in which Machiavelli works after 1498, and then on to the Medici. You actually see continuity of personnel. A lot of the people working in or occupying key offices remains pretty constant. Mm-hmm. Remain pretty constant. They feature in many of these different regimes. Their allegiances are not always fixed. Now, there are very different factions. When the Medici return in 1512, there's one group who want to see a very narrow oligarchy at the top, you know, not necessarily holding all the posts, but at least in influence. Another group wants quite a big oligarchic group. They want the Medici to work with a much bigger range of grandi. And then there's another group of people who want the people, the popolo, to still have some influence through major councils as well. So it's really differences in how you jiggle these groups around more than anything else. It's also, politics is also quite often a moral question. And this is something that sets Machiavelli apart from many other contemporary thinkers at the time. It's more concerned with how you are a good public figure, how you should approach ethically the question of public service, how you should morally engage with the life of a republic. That's more important than anything else. Now, Machiavelli, of course, does write a lot about how you should structure a republic. Many of his lesser works are concerned with precisely this issue, but I don't know whether he would necessarily, and he does also speak a lot about the great Aristotelian division between the different types of constitution as well. So he recognizes categories, but I don't think he would really have thought of himself or thought of anybody in terms of, you know, republican or autocrat or, you know, authoritarian by tendency. So I think it's quite difficult in that respect.
Yeah, drawing on this idea of, you know, not adhering to sort of extremely specific modes or ways of being politically, you know, Democrat, Republican, etc. This doesn't necessarily apply in the way that it does now to the political culture of the Renaissance. And one of the things I found really, really interesting in your biography is you point out that Machiavelli is influenced by Lucretius's work, and well, it would have only been Lucretius's text *De Rerum Natura*, which is the sort of atomist, famously has the, you know, you can't step in the same river twice idea, but also the idea of the clinamen, which is basically the birth of disorder within order. And do you think that the influence for Machiavelli from Lucretius is that instead of dealing with specific modes of governance, what Machiavelli is sort of attempting to deal with is the idea of retaining order when disorder comes along? And from Lucretius's idea, disorder doesn't come along in any formed way. Disorder is, you know, like the clinamen, completely spontaneous and random, and then you just have to deal with that effect.
Well, I think that's a really very good point, actually, and I think this would be maybe one of the coders I would add to my previous response, actually. Quite early in Machiavelli's life, he comes into contact with Lucretius. It's difficult to be certain exactly what his introduction is, but it is possible that he encountered Lucretius through the lectures of a chap called Marcello di Virgilio Adriani, who is his colleague in the chancellery later on. Machiavelli is the second chancellor, and Adriani is the first chancellor. They have different roles. Adriani, in the early part of his career, before becoming chancellor, delivers a series of lectures at the Florentine studio at Machiavelli University. And in the beginning of each year for 4 years, he delivers a big lecture. And each of these, in some way or another, touch upon Lucretius. And in his last introductory lecture in 1497, Adriani said, you know, really speaks about the utility of studying the ancient world. And he says, look, from, you know, today we're often stunned by how confusing the world seems and how traumatic the change is. But if we, you know, study the ancient classics, we can actually see that there's not so much that's puzzling. Lucretius teaches us that fortune, nature, and God are the ultimate cause of all the strange things that go on. And once we recognize this cause, once we appreciate that this is really what's driving everything, all our fear can dissipate. Now, Machiavelli, we don't know for certain whether Machiavelli heard this lecture or not, but certainly a little while later, he begins work on an annotated transcription of Lucretius's great work, the De Rerum Natura. And we still have this, and we can see the little notes he made in the margins beside certain texts. So he very much likes the observation that the gods are not moved by anger and pity. He sort of says, you know, the gods don't care about us, they just do what they like anyway. And he also makes a note of this idea that you alluded to of clinamen, the swerve of atoms. And why is this important? For Machiavelli, this is important because it suggests that even in a world of turbulence, where fortune, nature, and God lead to all these kind of strange, unpredictable twists, there is still room for human free will. And that is really important for Machiavelli. Although in the majority of his, in all of his writings after that point, he never mentions Lucretius by name, I'm pretty sure, once after that point. This idea really is a thread running through his works. As I said at the very beginning of our discussion, fortune is the big issue for him. He knows that fortune is unpredictable, wild. One moment she can make you king of the world, the next moment she can throw you down in the streets. It's really unpredictable. So the key for Machiavelli is to know how to respond. And really that's at the heart of a lot of his works, like the work he writes called The Gidivizi, which is written after he's impressed by how Julius II deals with a rebellious mercenary commander. And he says, you know, this shows us how we have to be tough, how we have to seize the moment, not be indecisive. When fortune comes along, you've got to, you know, grab hold of the moment and act decisively. And it's also at the heart of the prince as well. He considers specifically the case of how a prince who has risen to power through fortune and with the arms of others can keep his position. And we'll talk about what he says about that in a minute, I'm sure. Whether we can describe Machiavelli as a Lucretian political philosopher is, I think, an open question. I would be very, very hesitant about saying that. But we can certainly say with some degree of certainty that Lucretius's ideas do find their way into his brain and stay there.
I think one of the difficulties as well is that in calling Machiavelli a Lucretian, by sort of proxy, you're understanding him as sympathetic to Epicureanism as well. So there would be a lot, as you know, Lucretius was an Epicurean, so there would be a lot going on there if you were to consider him that way. And a Lucretian politics is sort of a scary idea, especially with regards to De Rerum Natura. And so in what sense do you think this has direct influence on the way that Machiavelli understands one should rule?
I think maybe it's worth reiterating the contrast with other previous approaches to fortune. As I said a little while ago, in the past, a lot of people had believed that if you were confronted with fortune, as particularly in a role of political authority, the best way of dealing with it was to adopt two stances. One was to personally treat it with a degree of stoicism, to accept the impermanence of things and realize that everything is just passing us by, as it were. And in a Christian sense, that we should also place our faith in the true happiness that is to, and permanent happiness that we found in thereafter. And secondly, with that in mind, to navigate our way through the turbulent waters of fortune with virtue as our guide, and to cling to the usual virtues of honesty, compassion, generosity, etc., etc. Machiavelli thinks all that is complete hogwash, and that rather than being, just being indifferent to how much our little boat is being tossed about on the waves, we should try and steer a different course. And to that end, we should not have any patience with this moralistic nonsense. But more of that later, I'm sure.
Does he use that metaphor specifically, the metaphor of steering a course, like in an ocean?
I don't know, actually. I don't recall for certain. More often when he talks about fortune, he uses the idea of fortune as a woman, which is unfortunate from our point of view. But it's his favourite image. He says you have to be rough, unfortunately.
Yeah, I mean, he wasn't the best husband either.
No, he's awful. He was absolutely atrocious.
And almost every moment, it seems, when his wife is sort of saying, can you come back and, we need to spend some time together, he almost gets there, and then some letter or something arrives, and he says, well, I need to do this just to heighten my career a little bit more, so I'll be away for another, few weeks.
Yeah, I think that's true, and it needs a bit of qualification as well. He is, in fairness to him, he does love his wife. There's absolutely no doubt that he really loves Marietta. There's very little correspondence between them that survives. There's a few letters from Marietta to Machiavelli. But the tone of her correspondence suggests that, her letters suggest that they care for each other very much. And in fact, one of the last letters Machiavelli writes in his entire life is to one of his younger sons. And to my knowledge, he very rarely mentions God directly in his letters, especially in a personal capacity. But at the very end of this letter, when he is dashing back to Florence, trying to keep ahead of an advancing army of German Landsknecht bearing down on his home, he writes to his son. He says, look, here's a bunch of advice for how you should deal with the everyday affairs, and, may God look after you and my wife. And that really shows the depth of his feeling. However, loving his wife didn't mean that he wasn't also a rogue of the first order. He was always, as you say, staying away longer than he should have done. He was always often leaving her short of cash. And he was constantly having affairs with girls and guys. We know of a number of ladies with whom he had long-running affairs. There are a couple who could totally dominate his world for a while. When he's an old man, he goes up with a girl called Barbara Salutati. Before that, there's a girl called La Tafani, with whom he is having an affair when he's writing a prince. And there's a whole bunch of male and female prostitutes as well. So he's a really, really, really bad husband.
Hmm. Just to jump back to this, the metaphor you were using with governance and not accepting the Lucretian fate of being just washed around in the current of sort of atomic spontaneity. He is inspired later on by the sort of political tactics of Rome of extreme forgiveness or extreme punishment, in that, when a state rebels, you either sort of flourish them with gifts so that they'll be so enamored by your generosity that they'll never rebel again, or you just absolutely level them and destroy everything and overtake them. Do you think that
Absolutely.
Do you think that for Machiavelli, with regards to this Lucretian outlook, he would understand any middle or nuanced path of political tactics as sort of giving in to the flow? Like, you really need to set your case against the nature of the world.
He really doesn't see the middle ground at all. It's useful that you allude to the example of Roman history, and the episode to which I think you're specifically referring there is the Battle of the Caudine Forks, where I think it was the Samnites against the fighting the Romans. I'd be wrong about that, but certainly the Roman army gets surprised in a valley, and the entire army gets captured. This threatens to ruin the whole city in early stage of history. And the Samnite commander doesn't know what to do. He's got the Romans prisoner, so he writes to his dad and he says, "Look, what should I do?" And the dad writes, I think in the first instance, the father says, "Kill them all of them to a man." And this is quite severe, so he writes back to his dad and says, "You know, sure." And the dad says, "Let them all go." Or maybe it's the other way around, I can't remember which one. And yet, the commander is just bewildered now. He doesn't know what to do. And so he says, "Dad, come here and tell me about this." And so the dad says, "Why have each piece of advice is absolutely correct. In this situation, you either need to win the Romans over with kindness. You need to make them your friends so that you never go to war again. They don't want to go to war with you again. Or you hit them so hard they never, ever want to take up arms against you again. Love or fear." And Machiavelli is absolutely captivated by this idea. In some of his very earliest writings, works that we don't often see in print, actually, works like called the Discorso sopra le cose di Pisa, a discourse on the affairs of Pisa. Pisa had rebelled, it had been a Florentine possession. It had rebelled and declared its independence from Florence in 1494. And this had really dealt Florentines a major blow. It cut their access, or limited their access to the sea, and therefore it had a big impact on the Florentine economy, and particularly on grain supplies. So Florence tries its utmost to capture Florence again. And for the next more than 10 years, 15, 16 years, it is just focused on recapturing the Pisans. And Machiavelli, soon after coming to office, writes a little work in which he considers how to deal with them. And he says, "Look, we either have to win them over with niceness, or we have to just obliterate them. And there's no middle ground. Nothing else will work. In fact, the whole point of his engagement with foreign affairs and the war with Pisa for the next few years is dominated by this idea that any middle ground is going to fail. He repeats the same advice when he deals with another rebellious town, Pistoia, a few years later. And he says, "Look, you've got people who are beating each other up really badly. You're never, and this threatens our control, you're never, ever, ever going to establish control if you don't either wow them with your kindness or horrify them with your cruelty." Now, over time, he comes to qualify this idea slightly. He says that kindness and love is great in its way, but if you rely on making the people over whom you rule love you, you run the risk that at some point in the future they might change their minds. So it's an unstable foundation on which to build. Fear is much the better way. Now, he wasn't the first to think in this way by any stretch of the imagination. In 1499, Florence thinks that it's the commander of its army, a mercenary called Palavitelli, has made a hash of the war against Pisa. And they think he's done it so badly that either he's got to be incompetent or a traitor. And they decide he's a traitor. So then they have to ask the question, what should we do with him? And there's a big debate, and most people, including Machiavelli, are in favor of killing him. And at the big debate, there's this guy called Bernardo Rucellai, and he says, "Look, in matters of state, you must choose fear over love. There is no choice, and there's certainly no middle ground. We must kill this guy pour encourager les autres," to use the French phrase. "We must, you know, do this so the other commanders don't dare do the same."
Is that the well, no, clearly it would be the primary tactic. One sort of big question I have is that the prince, as we understand it now, I mean, I don't know the history too well on this. Maybe you can enlighten me on it. But it's considered basically the first work of political philosophy, like the first coherent work, which is completely directed towards that idea. Maybe you can comment on that. But the main question here is, the prince has become renowned as this work, and is famous for this, and is extremely, obviously extremely well known text. But it's become a classic of sorts. Was it as popular in its day, considering that Machiavelli wrote it sort of to get a job?
Well, the prince certainly wasn't the first work of political philosophy by any stretch of the imagination. As long as people have been writing philosophy, they have been writing political philosophy. But where it is unusual is that it is extraordinarily pragmatic. It is distinguished by a brutal, uncompromising realism. It consciously sets itself apart from any highfalutin ideas of being nice. Machiavelli says, you know, if you want to keep power, if you've risen to power through fortune and the arms of others, which the Medici had, you can't mess around being nice. You can't, you know, have any truck with the idea of being honest, being generous, being compassionate, etc., etc. You have to be tough. You need soldiers of your own that you can rely on. You need to be prepared to be dishonest if it's going to keep you under control. You need to be parsimonious, because then you won't have to burden people with taxes. You need to be extremely cruel if necessary, but you also need to be aware that you shouldn't arouse ire. So it's unusual in that it is offering a very hard-nosed, pragmatic answer to a very common question. You know, how people should, how princes could stay in power was a topic that, how they should rule, was a topic that had been written about since classical antiquity. We've got Xenophon writes about it, Seneca writes about it, but Machiavelli is not interested in virtue in the sense of being good. He's interested in virtue in the sense of being a vir, in being a tough man.
Could we say it's potentially the first work of political strategy then? Perhaps not.
It depends how you
it's
certainly the first work of realpolitik. That might be a good way of putting it. Its influence. Well, although it is written as a piece of advice, it's obvious from the preface that he writes, the dedicated letter he writes to Lorenzo de' Medici, that he is recommending himself as an advisor. But as soon as it appears, first in manuscript, it is never printed during Machiavelli's life, it raises question marks. People aren't sure, because it is so, sets itself so much against ethical ideas of rulership, people aren't really sure whether he means this to be taken seriously or not. Mm-hmm. And this big question, is he really saying this, is a question that moves to the fore after it's published for the first time in 1532, 5 years after his death. Opinions fall into two major camps. Some people assume that it is a satire. Mm-hmm. And I personally don't adhere to that view. There are even some historians today who argue that. I just don't think it's true. There's no actual evidence for that. But some readers think that it's so shocking that it must be a satire. Or it is quite a dark and hard set of advice. It is read very widely after Machiavelli's death. It's one of his most printed, most translated, most read works. It wasn't the first to be translated, that was The Art of War, but it was an early work used to be translated. And it elicits very sharp responses. Reginald Pohl, Cardinal Reginald Pole, who's an associate of Mary I of England, spent a lot of his time abroad during the Reformation, the English Reformation. He says that it must have been written by Satan's hand. And often in the wars of religion, both Catholics and Protestants hold it up as a model of everything they think is wrong with the other side's rulership at the time. So it becomes a kind of shorthand for what we shouldn't do. But it is taken seriously by a lot of other figures as well. And it does have a very serious influence on the methods we use to analyse politics. It's part of this movement towards the idea of the reason of state, the idea that states operate according to different principles to ordinary people or individuals, and so require a different framework for analysis. And in that respect, its influence is profound.
Is there? I mean, of course, there's been tons of stuff we've missed, and we could talk about this all day. But is there anything you would like to add in, or something that we've glossed over that you find, you know, extremely interesting about Machiavelli, or, you know, extremely unique?
Well, I don't, to say the things that are unique about Machiavelli is to sort of open a can of worms, really. But maybe I could sort of add a little kind of word and recommendation of Machiavelli. We just spoke a little bit about the prince, and because of the prince, he unfortunately has had a bit of a rough ride in popular culture. You know, even Shakespeare speaks about him very negatively. But I would like to say that he's a tremendous. I've always found him to be a very human character, very approachable, very engaging person. So at the beginning, he makes mistakes all the time. He gives the impression that, or it is easy to get the impression from reading The Prince that he is this wonderful political genius, but actually his diplomatic skills are very, very variable. He often gets things terribly, terribly wrong and is reproved by very important figures around Europe for being so dim or just not quite appreciating what's going on. Politically, he's always on the wrong side. When he speaks up most ardently in support against the Medici, it's just before they come back to power. He just gets back in with the Medici a little while before they're chucked out again. He's always in the wrong place at the wrong time doing the wrong thing. But throughout, he's always, you know, thinking, reading, and having fun. Aside from his political works, he writes a lot of poems that are very, very funny, very touching, very moving. He writes comedies, which have musicals. In fact, you could say that he's the first, some people say that he's even a forerunner of a pioneer of early opera. He writes funny ghost stories too. He's a very rounded individual to whom there is a lot more than just the prince. So I would say, if you're keen on Machiavelli, then look at the man, not just the works.
Okay.
Look beyond the most common works.
Yeah. And whereabouts is the best place to get your book?
Oh, that's very kind of you to ask. It's available on Amazon for listeners in the US. It will be published in the United States, or made available in the United States, hopefully at the beginning of next year. But for the moment, it's also available through websites like Book Depository. And of course, for everyone, certainly available in your local bookstores, and I heartily encourage people to go to independent bookshops, which have been hard hit by the pandemic. So please do keep an eye out for it on the shelves.
Okay. Alexander Lee, thanks very much.
Thank you very much for having me.